Now, my wonderful friends and colleagues in Initiatives of Change the World Over did me the very great honor last year of electing me as the president of Initiatives of Change International for last year and for this year. And I felt that I should be of some use to the teams associated with Initiatives of Change in different parts of the world in a concrete way. And one way in which I could do this was to take time and take leave from the university and take unpaid leave from the university, which is what I've done. And so, along with some who are here in this room, Chris Breitenberg is here as part of this voyage. My wife, Usha, is here. So we embarked on this voyage of dialogue and discovery. And we went to, not all of us did all the countries together, but my wife and I did all these countries. Sri Lanka, India, of course, Indonesia, South Africa, Kenya, Palestine, Israel, Norway, Romania, Ukraine, and Japan. And then after a few days in Washington, D.C., by the way, I regard this visit to Washington, D.C. from Illinois as part of the voyage of discovery. And then scheduled to be in Mexico and Colombia and Brazil. So I wanted just, I'm not going to inflict a detailed report of each country, but certainly just say that building trust across the world's divides seemed very appropriate in country after country. In Sri Lanka, there is the Sinhala-Tamil divide. I once met a person from a Tamil background in Sri Lanka. This was many years ago. This was well before apartheid ended in South Africa. And he said to me, everybody speaks about South Africa, but the problem there is skin deep. In Sri Lanka, it is soul deep. In Indonesia, among other divides, there is a divide between the center and the provinces, a very major divide in Indonesia. By the way, amazing country, Indonesia, with absolutely inspiring young people. South Africa, not only the divide, continuing divide between the races, but an amazing divide, sad divide, between the well-established and the marginalized people. The unemployment there is 40%. In Kenya, the divide between the various ethnic groups that we were all read about, killings that took 1,200 lives within a few days after the last election 2 years ago. In Ukraine, the divide between the eastern portion and the western portion, which is a religious divide, also a linguistic divide, political divide. In Japan, the divide between within political parties and between political parties. And the Japanese are very keen also now to improve their ties with China and other Asian countries. And also the Japan-United States relationship is a very crucial one, cannot be taken for granted. So I certainly felt, Usha and I felt, as we worked with our wonderful associates in all these countries, that these were divides where the spirit of Caux, of reflection and reconciliation and honest dialogue and listening was very, very much needed. Now I want to mention just one thing from our time in Palestine. On one day, Usha and I were both in the church where Jesus was believed to have been born, and also in Abraham's tomb in Hebron, the same day, in both these places. And of course, Abraham is someone that Jews and Christians and Muslims revere and honor. And in both these places, I took time to be silent for several minutes and in my own mind to pray, very deeply to pray. And I prayed for the independence of Palestine. I have to say, without any hesitation, I deeply prayed for the independence of Calcutta. And I deeply prayed in both these places for the security of the people of Israel. So I wanted to say that. But that was a very important part of this voyage, and I felt a very great privilege that I could be in these sacred places and make that heartfelt prayer. Now it seems to me that there are two approaches to the challenge of violence in the world. There is a challenge of violence, of extremism in the world, and violence of all kinds. And one approach says that the only way to create peace is by having very strong armed defenses. And there's another approach that says that peace can come through dialogue, honest dialogue, and that justice and forgiveness can together be sought through honest dialogue, and that reconciliation may take place. These are two distinct approaches, but these are not approaches in opposition to each other. They can be complementary approaches, but these are two distinct approaches. And I'm certainly grateful to the Almighty that I've had the privilege of devoting several years of my life in this second approach. I'm not opposed to the first approach. I feel that you cannot have peace in the world merely by disbanding the defense forces of the world. I think that would be really an absurd thing to do. Although I think there's a strong case for reducing these forces, a very strong case. But my life is along with so many wonderful people dedicated to seeking justice and forgiveness, and therefore reconciliation together. Now, I said that people come to the United States sometimes to settle down forever, sometimes to Switzerland to have their problems sorted out. Why do they come to India? Sometimes to seek some spiritual truths, but more often than not, what happens when they come to India is that their stamina is tested. India's population, India's sounds and noise and traffic, poverty, really tests our stamina. But it seems to me that we do need to fortify our mental and moral stamina if we are to face the challenges of our world today. I don't think that there is a guarantee that in 3 years or 5 years, and the Master was so right to say that we should be realistic enough to aim for very modest changes in the world. I don't think we'll have a guarantee that the world can change dramatically in a short time. But I do say it is wrong to believe that there is a guarantee that the world will always remain the way it is. Did we expect in 1989 the Soviet Empire to go away? Did we expect in the early 90s apartheid to end in South Africa? Did we expect the 2008 election result? So as we continue with our patience and seeking to strengthen our stamina, I think we might expect that some great events will take place to encourage us along the way. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Mr. Ambassador, very much for hosting.